الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ثم أما بعد، Muslims in the United States, in 2022, are still facing the same challenge that we face every year, every decade, which is how to be fully integrated in this society, how to positively impact the society at large without being negatively impacted by the society, how to preserve our Muslim identity for generations to come, and whether or not we, parents and grandparents and community leaders and imams and scholars, are doing our job in disseminating authentic and relevant Islamic knowledge and providing spiritual, educational, social environment for our kids to be raised according to the Islamic principles or not. As we are growing in this society, this challenge is growing with us, and we have no choice but to face it if we really care about the future of Islam in this society. With the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are experiencing more masajid and more Islamic schools, more Islamic organizations, but I do believe that the amount of effort that we are exerting day and night, parents and grandparents and community leaders, scholars and mashayikh and imams, is still insufficient. We have a long way to go. And to make my case clear, if you choose any Muslim community randomly in the United States and pass a survey within our teenagers, our youth, especially those who did not get a chance to attend Islamic school, just to find out how many among those kids, teenagers, youth, boys and girls, can properly recite Surah Al-Fatiha with no mistakes? And how many amongst them can master the rules of tahara and purification, wudu and salah? You will be surprised. This is not to ridicule or to belittle the effort that we are doing day and night. It is just to bring to our attention that the challenge is still there and we have a long way to go. And without having authentic and relevant Islamic knowledge accessible, available, understandable to the community at large, we cannot proceed further. Because the most important thing for the preservation of the Muslim identity is to be knowledgeable about your deen, how to practice your deen in a moderate way, without being liberal, without being extremist, with the proper understanding, which is حسن الفهم عن الله ورسوله, That is the challenge. The new generation in this country is facing a lot of challenges as well. We're talking about homosexuality, LGBT, drug addiction, porn addiction, atheism, the list goes on and on. Are we up to the challenge or not? Is our approach reasonable, understandable to the next generation or not? How did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describe the situation when the Islamic knowledge is getting less and less, when the Islamic knowledge gets terminated gradually? What will be the consequence of lacking Islamic knowledge? I don't want to say he predicted, but he was informed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this situation might happen, and it does happen. Maybe you can ask me, as someone who is working in education, in Islamic education, have been traveling across the United States from coast to coast for the last 17, 18 years of my stay in this society. And I did come across some communities where there is no single individual, believe it or not, a male or female, a brother or a sister, who is qualified enough to be the religious authority of that particular community. How did the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam assess the situation? He said in the hadith, a very authentic one, قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah will not terminate knowledge, of course Islamic knowledge, by snatching it from people. This is not the way that the Islamic knowledge is terminated. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. But the Islamic knowledge could be terminated by the death of scholars. يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Islamic knowledge could be terminated, eliminated by taking away the souls of scholars. Someone might ask a question, do not we have enough resources nowadays? Print resources every time, everywhere. Different books of fiqh and madhahib and tafsir and hadith and tajweed and qiraat and aqeedah. We do have a lot. Then what kind of problem we are facing here? Do not we have online resources, digital resources? We have a lot. But believe it or not, this is a part of the problem. Because navigating and going through those books or going online searching for a certain mas'ala in your mind is not the right way of seeking knowledge. Sometimes we go online searching for a certain mas'ala, certain question. And I have in my mind the question, and I have in my mind the answer that I want to find. That is called nowadays fatwa shopping. Unfortunately, it became a phenomenon. Fatwa shopping is to have a question and to navigate and look for the answer that you want, and you will find it, believe it or not. This is not the right way of seeking knowledge. Absolutely, it is not the right way. You go sometimes to a website searching for a fiqh question, and you do not know what kind of mufti that individual is, whether that website belongs to Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, or the Baha'i, or the Ismaili, or the Shi'i, or whatever sect might be. We do not know. How can we trust that source and take that knowledge from? You open the book and search for a mas'ala related to fiqh of riba, for example. How can you make sure that that answer of that question complies with the real case that you are looking for? Matching the adilla, the evidences, and the fiqh ruling from one side with the contemporary issues from the other side is the job of people of knowledge who can do something very technical called tahqiq al-manat, searching for the compliance between the dalil and the contemporary issue. We all know, for example, that riba is haram. is cash withdrawal using your credit card, not debit card? Is it the riba that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited or not? That's something you cannot find it in the traditional fiqh books. Eating from the meat of the people of the book is permissible. وَطَعَامُ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ حِلُّ لَكُمْ وَطَعَامُكُمْ حِلُّ لَهُمْ. Going to regular American restaurants nowadays in the US, is it still permissible or not? That is something completely different from the ruling. There are certain issues, contemporary issues, are not captured by those fatawa. So this is not the right way of seeking knowledge. That's why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, because the knowledge is to be taken from the mouth of the scholars. Let me ask you this. How did Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام himself receive the Quran that we recite day and night? Directly from Jibreel عليه الصلاة والسلام. Jibreel has received it from رب العزة والجلال سبحانه وتعالى. The Sahaba رضي الله عنهم surrounded the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام decades, praying behind him, shaking his hand, sitting with him, meeting with him, traveling with him, interacting with him, transacting with him, until they absorbed the proper way of reciting Quran, until they absorbed the proper way of implementing their deen through the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. That's called التلقين or التلقي, indoctrination. Indoctrination. You meet with the scholar face to face. You ask the question, you receive the answer because he knows or she knows the exact answer for your question. That's why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was so insistent by saying, وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Scholars are not angels. They live like other people, 60, 70 years, and then they pass away. Sometimes they pass in their early age. One individual in the United States made a lot of influence for maybe more than 20 years. A young man with the name of Muhammad al-Sharif, rahmatullahi alayhi, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, the founder of Al-Maghrib Institute. He was a young man, went to Saudi Arabia to receive his classical education there. But he was a person with a vision and a mission. He wanted to traditionalize and Americanize as well the Islamic knowledge by making it accessible, understandable to the new generation in the United States. He came with a vision from Saudi Arabia, established the Maghrib Institute with the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because of this man, hundreds of thousands of Muslim youth in North America, well, across the globe actually, have benefited from Al-Maghrib Institute because of only one individual. That individual passed away just a few weeks ago. Rahimahullah wa rahmatan wasi'ah. Which is a disaster by itself. When someone like Muhammad al-Sharif passes away, leaving that big gap behind him, we need to make sure that someone is filling that gap. وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The hadith goes, حتى إذا لم يبق عالما, until he leaves no knowledgeable individuals, and that might happen, it does happen unfortunately. As I said, I came across some communities in which the whole community at large does not have one single individual who is knowledgeable enough to answer the questions of the community and to take his or her responsibility as the religious authority. And someone might ask another question. Do not we have a lot of scholars overseas where we can ask? And my answer is yes and no at the same time. Yes, we do have a lot of respected scholars overseas, but no, they are not the right people to be asked because they have the theoretical knowledge, not the practical knowledge. They did not live in the United States. They do not feel the pain of the Muslim community. They do not know the prevailing culture of the United States. They do not know the limitations and the restrictions and the guidelines. They did not face the challenges that you and I are facing on a daily basis. They have no clue whatsoever of what's going on. Thus, they are not the right people to be asked. Wallahi, with all due respect. Give it a try. Ask someone that you trust living overseas about student loans, about retirement accounts, about holding credit card, for example, and just mention the name or the word riba, that all these different transactions do involve riba. And the answer will be, well, that's haram, just stay away from it. As simple as that. Which is, wallahi, with all due respect, a very inaccurate answer. Those are not the right people to be asked. You need someone who lives in the same society, in the same country, who feels your pain, who knows the system of the United States, to be asked. Now, this part of the hadith, حتى إذا لم يبقي عالما, until he leaves no scholars, no people of knowledge, indicates clearly that as long as people of knowledge are striving and going extra miles to reach out to the community, to educate the community, no one can compete with them. People actually are very sophisticated and very smart. They can differentiate between people of knowledge and people of no knowledge. However, some of our scholars here are so relaxed, excuse me, all so lazy. They are not willing to go out and to reach out to the community and to take the responsibility of educating the community. That's why sometimes ignorant individuals jump in and just act as scholars, while they are not. حتى إذا لم يبقي عالما, what will happen? قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا. When there is a vacancy, it has to be filled. And that's the nature and the culture of the Muslim community. We have to have religious authority. We cannot function without having religious authority, which is something good. فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون. Asking people of knowledge is a wonderful sign. It shows that you so care about your deen. You want to implement your deen the right way. But the challenge here, who is the right person to ask? Who is that knowledgeable individual to ask? اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا. Some ignorant individuals will be just filling that gap, acting and behaving like scholars while they are not. And those people, unfortunately, will be approached by the community at large. That's why in the hadith they said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا فسئلوا فأفتوا بغير علم. They will be approached, they will be asked by their community at large. And because of being so ignorant, they cannot take it to be embarrassed or to be put in the spot or to say, I do not know. They would just make up any answer and just move on. By the way, if you come across any individual who tells you, ask of me whatever you want, I know everything, that is the person that you need to avoid. People of knowledge will never ever say that I know everything. People of knowledge, with the true knowledge, be so hesitant and reluctant to open their mouth and to say something on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without having knowledge. This reminds us all with the story of Malik ibn Anas radiallahu anhu. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا مَالِكِ ابْنُ أَنَسِ. The most knowledgeable individual during his lifetime. The founder of the Maliki school of thought. He was sitting in the masjid of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam one day, giving his daily halaqa to his students of knowledge. And upon completion, someone came from outside of Al-Madina with a wonderful list of questions. And he started showering Malik ibn Anas with questions. Malik ibn Anas was put in the spot. He was not fully prepared. He kept nodding his head like this. And for the first question, he said, La Adri, I do not know. Second question, La Adri. And he kept showering him. The narration said that سُئِلَ أَرْبَعِينَ مَسْأَلَةً قَالَ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّنْهَا لَا أَدْرِي. He was showered with 40 different questions, in which in most of those questions he said, I do not know. I do not know. So much so that that inquirer got a kind of disappointed. He said, Ya Imam, what should I tell my community when I go back to them? He said, well, tell them, Malik ibn Anas does not know. Subhanallah. That is the attitude of people of knowledge. And he further said, to embarrass myself in front of you in front of my students by saying لا أدري, I do not know, is way better than or less harmful than embarrassing myself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by speaking on his behalf and putting my signature without having knowledge. Those are the people that you want to follow. Malik ibn Anas, Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. In fact, speaking on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without having knowledge is a kind of deviation from the right path. This is one of the ways that the shaytan takes you away from the right path. إِنَّمَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِالسُّوءِ وَالْفَحْشَاءِ وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Speaking on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without having knowledge, wallahi, is a crime. You are committing a crime if you pass a fatwa without having knowledge. The hadith goes, فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. They will go astray, those ignorant individuals acting as scholars, and they will take their community astray as well. Subhanallah. If you look at this hadith, is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam describing the situation for us only, just FYI? No, he is not. He is warning us. He is telling us, do not wait until you reach to a point where the whole Muslim community at large does not have enough individuals who have authentic and relevant and sound and deep Islamic knowledge, until some ignorant individual jumping in, acting as scholars, going astray and taking you astray. He is warning us. That is the message that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is sending when he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضُ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. أَقُولُ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ. الحمد لله كما أمر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إقرارا بربوبيته وإرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر، وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله بشر وأنذر. اللهم صل على محمد، ما اتصلت عين بنظر أو سمعت أذن بخبر. عباد الله، اتقوا الله فيما أمر، وانتهوا عما نهاكم عنه وزجر، وأخرجوا حب الدنيا من قلوبكم فإنه إذا استولى أسر. وحافظوا على الصلوات وعلى حضور الجمع والجماعات، واعلموا أن الله قد أمركم بأمر زادكم فيه تعظيما وتشريفا. فقال عز من قال، إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. لبيك اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات، الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، والباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان، واجعلنا اللهم من الراشدين. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وأقم الصلاة.